Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, thank you. That was really loud. So happy to see everybody here this morning. If you would please turn off your phones, or at least mute them, that would be great. Today, we have Bill Hoffman as our special musician, and we have Rick as our regular wonderful musician. So glad to see both of you here this morning. Dr. Maurita will be speaking today, and you all have a wonderful day. Thank you.
Good morning to you all.
Good morning. Good morning.
Do I have this on?
No.
No, I do not have this on. You see me different. I have this windsock here. We have a new kind of microphone. We're in hopes that it's going to produce a much better sound. And I don't know where to turn this on. Oh, up here, I guess. Since it's the first
time. Now.
There you go.
Too loud. Way.
Well, you wanted it loud.
Yes, I wanted it clear. Oh my goodness. What a pleasure to be with you all. And I see some faces I haven't seen in a long time, and they're so welcome. Thank you for coming today. Thank you for joining us in a celebration of life, a celebration of good, a celebration of the omnipresence of God. Well, my first task this morning is to pick out a verse from the Bible. And let's see what I decided. Here we go, Psalm 18. It is God that girdeth me with strength. God that girdeth me with strength. Goodness knows there are times when we need strength, when we need patience, when we need more understanding, and maybe we just need to love ourselves. Maybe we need to turn on the faucet of compassion for ourselves. I hear feedback from this.
Let me check this microphone.
Okay.
I think I turned this off. Check
it.
See. This is off.
It is off.
I don't think it's feedback. I think it's too close to your mouth, and so it's still a little bit fuzzy.
Okay. How about this? Is that any better? Pardon all this tryouts of stuff. But let me go back to this. It is God that girdeth me with strength. And there is another passage also from Jeremiah. Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? No, of course not. Nothing is too hard for God. This gets too hard for us sometimes, but not for God. And that is the source of our strength. When we don't think we can, God can through us and with us. I don't know about you, but I sort of get a sigh after I say something like that to myself. Thank goodness that I can depend on a source that is eternal and that loves me unconditionally. And as we know this truth about ourselves, we are less worried about life, we're less fearful about the changes, the pandemic, etc., 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 that are going on. Unusual for our country, unique for our country. Someone once asked me, have you ever had a time like this in your life before? Politically, socially, physically, with the illnesses? And I had to tell them no. I haven't ever experienced this kind of upheaval in life. But it is God that girdeth me with strength. It is God who makes it possible for me to take a deep breath and know that things are going to be all right. Things are going to be just fine. I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? Mm-mm. Never. That's something to put in your mental pocket. Remember it. Remember it a lot through your day. Because every one of us has challenges every day. Thank God for God. Shall we say our divine science statement of being? You'll see it right over here on the TV. God is all, both invisible and visible. One presence, one mind, one power is all. This one that is all is perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. I am the individualized expression of God, and am ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. Thank you. Bill is going to play for us.
Good morning.
I'm going to play a tune called There Will Never Be Another Year.
That's beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you. And now it's time for our healing meditation. And that's that time when we just go within, something that many of us have a hard time putting aside, that is a time to get still in our lives. To get tuned in, to get on the wavelength of not just the to-do list and what did they say and how am I going to do this, but to dip deep within ourselves. After closing our eyes and relaxing our shoulders, making sure our faces don't have any frowns, and the jaw is relaxed. Taking a few deep breaths and letting that air out slowly. For as we do this, we get on a different wavelength within ourselves. We get on that beam of peace and spirituality. Of relaxation and simply tuning into the truth that we are much more than just this physical body. Certainly we are mind, we are emotions, but our primary identity is spirit. It is the individualized expression of God. That is our basic identity. And as we get on that wavelength, as we tune into that reality that we generally don't think about through our days, we can tap into a stream of peace, a flow of understanding that we are loved beyond our imagination. We feel that buoyant sense of truth that I am unique. I am needed. I am loved. I have so much to give to this world. As we come to know that truth, because it is truth, we see through different eyes, we hear through different ears, life becomes different for us, welcoming, supportive, kind, benevolent. abundant in good. Good of every sort. Oh, just knowing this for a few moments, getting on that spiritual wavelength, heals us, body, mind, and emotions. And knowing that this is available to us and to anyone and everyone, we reach out on the breath of thought and love and concern. We reach out to all those who are on our Valley Community Church prayer list. We reach out to Nancy and so many others who are in need of help right now. And know that God, omnipresent, is right there with each and all. God is right there with your loved ones, your friends, your family. God is within and without. For every human being who walks the earth. And we need God's help. We need God's help more than ever today in our country and in all the countries of the world. In the next 90 seconds, let us give thanks for that presence, that bountiful, that loving, that peaceful, powerful presence within and around each and every one of us. We feel it, we know it, we rejoice in it, give thanks for it. And all the good that is coming forth, starting right now. Come unto me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I'll give you assurance. I'll give you a sense of optimism, a sense of expectation for greater good in your life, an opportunity to see new solutions to old problems, and a flow of support and greater understanding and good. That's what God is saying to us. He's saying, I love you, I'm with you. I'm here to support you, to sustain you, to heal you, to bless you in every dimension of your life. And we say, thank you that it is so. Amen and amen. Shall we say the affirmative version of the Lord's Prayer? It's from the Neura Foundation. It's the translation from the Aramaic, the language of Jesus. Together, our Father who is everywhere, your name is sacred, your kingdom is come, your will is throughout the earth, even as it is throughout the universe. You give us our needful bread from day to day, and you forgive us our offenses as we forgive our offenders. And you let us not enter into materialism, but you separate us from error, because yours are the kingdom, the power, and the song and praise from all ages, throughout all ages, sealed in faith, trust, and truth. Amen. Amen. Beautiful prayer. Well, today I'm going to be talking about healing and Emmet Fox. When we think about, or when we speak about Emmet Fox, we often think about, oh my gosh, all the books he wrote and the many pamphlets that have gone out and been printed in by the millions, really, and in most of the major languages of Earth. If his writings aren't exactly what come to mind, well then we might think in terms of his ministry, like on Wednesday evenings and Sunday mornings, he filled the largest halls in New York City, like the Hippodrome or Carnegie Hall, with maybe 5,000 to 6,000 people on a Sunday morning. And on special holidays like Easter, maybe 8,000 people. My goodness. So many would show up that sometimes hundreds had to be turned away. Ladies would even roll up their fancy mink coats and sit on the floor wherever they could find a spot. That's how much in demand he was. At the time, it was probably the largest congregation in this country. Even though he never did have a church building, he always met in or had his meetings in public spaces. He attracted people from all the walks of life. It was just a panorama of people, from bank presidents to grocers, from stenographers to famous doctors. Everybody wanted to hear him. So many did, anyway. But what was it about Fox that brought so many people into the church? He had a certain charisma that attracted people. I mean, out of his pulpit, just talking to somebody in a restaurant, other people would start leaning forward and listening because there was something about the man. He just attracted himself. Attracted people to himself, I should say. There was an authority in the way he comported himself, carried himself. But at the same time, he was charming and always, always positive, sometimes quite funny, sometimes, and yet he had a quiet dignity about himself. This man was a very intelligent person and had almost a photographic memory. And the keenest intuition, he could pick up vibes, he could know things that he wasn't told verbally or could see. And people were impressed with this, but mostly people were impressed with his spiritual qualities, his wisdom, and the healings, mental, emotional, certainly physical healings that he brought about through his ministry. They would receive just so much mail talking about literally miracles that had happened in people's lives when they followed the precepts that he was teaching from the pulpit. But those healings were not the new thing for him, because he'd experienced healings from his earliest years. Emmet was born in Ireland, and his father was a very famous surgeon as well as a member of Parliament. His father sadly died when he was 10 years old. Now, the family had been Catholic for generations. It's said that his mother had secretly hoped that he would become a Jesuit priest. But Emmet certainly got his early education from the Jesuits at the Jesuit College near London. But he became not a priest, but a chemical engineer. Excuse me, not chemical, electrical. He was an electrical engineer. That was his work for a number of years when he was a younger man. Then from early on, he was always interested in healing because he had a natural gift for healing. At the age of 6, when his mother would get a bad headache, he would place his hand on her forehead and the pain would ebb away and be replaced by a sense of peace. Later, the family maid had a sister who became quite ill. And he said to the sister, "Mary, Mary, you're going to be well. You're going to be well." And she got well. Now, at the time, even as a young, very young boy, he realized that it was the maid and her sister's faith that had healed her. He knew all his life that healing was something that everybody could do. It wasn't just confined to him by any means. Everybody had this talent within them. When Emmet was 18, he began seriously investigating the subject of healing, even though he was not a well young person himself. He had hearing and visual problems. His search for answers, for explanations, and that ability to heal as well, not only led him to start studying metaphysics, but its teachers, all the great religions, healers, and so forth. And it also weakened his faith in the precepts of the Catholic Church. Now, when the family kind of caught on to this, there was one very large confrontation. But that closed the subject. It was never discussed again. Now, he and his mother did share a deep respect for each other's inner faith, but Emmet needed the freedom to approach God in his own way, and he respected his family's right to approach God in their way. He always underplayed his fame, and he became very famous. He underplayed that in his interactions with his family out of respect for their Catholic faith. So much so that when he died and he was cremated, his sister Nora said, "Fancy him starting a new religion when we've got a perfectly good one." Mm-hmm. She had no idea what great work he had done, how famous he had become, and how many millions of people he helped. Now, this early interest in healing had led him to a class. It was taught by a divine science minister in London, a minister by the name of Reverend Harry Gaze. Now, Reverend Gaze encouraged him and through the years became a very good friend of his and supporter of Fox from his earliest years. In 1928, after he had achieved some very encouraging success speaking metaphysical talks around London and in England and various places, he found himself mentally debating whether he should continue being an electrical engineer, or maybe he should go full-time into speaking and the writing. Now, it was Harry Gaze, again, who reassured him that he should follow these inner promptings and that he should consider going to the United States. Well, it took until 1931, and of course, the Great Depression took place during that time. Maybe that was what slowed him up, who knows. But after a great deal of prayer and meditation, he got a clear signal that there should be a change. He needed to go to America. And he arrived with, I think it was a 3-month visa. He stayed for 20 years, actually, and became an American citizen. But there he was. He arrived unknown. Nobody in the United States knew him, but Florence Scovel Shinn, who was a well-known minister in New York, invited him to speak at her church while she was on vacation. That was the opening. He was an outstanding success. People packed the place to hear him. Now, the minister of the Church of the Healing Christ had recently died, and it had a secretary by the name of Reverend Herman Walhorn, a divine science minister. I met Herman's many years ago now. And Herman recognized the potential of this young man and invited him to become the minister of the Church of the Healing Christ. And he accepted. He did. And Herman and Blanche, his wife, Herman and Blanche Walhorn became his dearest friends and were his travel companions during the yearly church summer break that took place between the end of June and the beginning of October. Why so long? There wasn't any air conditioning back in those days. And those venues would have been very, very hot and uncomfortable. So they took wonderful trips, the Walhorns and Dr. Fox. So what did Fox preach between October and June? Well, he tried to awaken his congregation's confidence, a faith in God. He wanted them to realize that they had to claim their good for themselves. It was available, but they had to claim it. He said, "The goodness of God is unchangeable. If you don't experience it, the fault is yours for not choosing it." How many of us deliberately choose the best? Think in those terms. His advice was right on. Fox reminded everyone that the divine wouldn't make you if he didn't need you. There just isn't an unnecessary human being in the world. He said, you have to put God first in your life. Your own true spiritual development must become the only thing that really matters. That can be an inner decision that you want to grow spiritually because that's what life on this planet is the greatest opportunity for. Again and again, though, he emphasized the importance of the control of thoughts. He quoted an Eastern sage who once said, "All that we are is the result of what we have thought." All that we are is the result of what we have thought. Now, Paul said the same thing in different words. We are transformed by the renewing of our minds. That's the way Paul put it. But Fox said, You choose all the conditions of your life when you choose the thoughts upon which you allow your mind to dwell. Thought is the real causative force in life, and there is no other. I'm going to repeat that. Thought is the real causative force in life, and there is no other. There were two lessons that ran throughout his work, his talks, and in his own private life as well. One was the lesson of the omnipresence of God. And the second was the power of thought. Two so important ideas, central ideas. Fox believed that healing was an essential part of the Jesus Christ teaching. And although he did laying on of hands when he was just a young boy, as a minister, he preferred using what he called scientific prayer. And scientific prayer was the practice of the presence of God, to know that God is with you and within you, all around you, everywhere present. Now, people wanted answers to questions, and they were invited to write down their questions on a piece of paper and turn them in. And Dr. Fox would answer these questions after the Wednesday and Friday noon lectures. People find this so helpful because it spoke to exactly what they were concerned about, what they were thinking, talking with friends about, and so forth. And during the Second World War, he got questions like, how can I help a man who is in the war? And he answered, get fear out of your own heart. Treat yourself. Get that fear out of your heart and he'll be safe. Pray until you feel satisfied that God is with you. That's the very best treatment of all. And he said, use a hymn or an affirmation or whatever it is that touches you, that moves you. It doesn't matter what it is, but that it has an effect on you. Those words mean something important to you. Now, those words certainly echoed in my mind, that is, to get fear out of your heart. And this will be of help to others. Because, like so many people, I watched TV last Tuesday night. I had no intention of staying up all night to hear how things unfolded. So I went to bed, went to sleep, and woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning, filled with fear. I was laying there in the bed and thinking, what's going to happen to the country? There's this, and then there's that. And what if this goes on? Or this could happen? Or what if? And I was going around and around in my head, and I finally sat up in my bed. And I can't remember being so filled with fear. Maybe I have been, but I certainly hasn't been in quite a while, a long time. I thought about turning on the TV just to see what was happening there, and I thought, no, 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 I'm not going to do that. This is a crisis in faith, because if you're in the midst of fear, you're not practicing faith. And so I sat there, and try as I might, I just couldn't seem to get calm. I just could not settle down and get still. And I kept trying, and finally, I started saying the 23rd Psalm to myself. I love that prayer. The Lord is my shepherd. And the shepherd means loving guidance, protection. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. That's what the shepherd does. He leads his sheep into the tenderest, the most wonderful meadows that he can find where the grass is green and tender. And he leads them beside still waters. Sheep don't like very rapidly flowing water. They prefer it quiet water. It doesn't frighten them. And that's the way the good shepherd takes care of his sheep. And that is what God does for us. That is the protection that we're afforded all the time. He restoreth my soul. Yes, your soul is restored when you can move out of fear into faith. He leadeth me into paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Righteousness, the right use of my mind, the right use of my thoughts, and guard them, change them, for his name's sake. Well, name and nature were the same thing in the Bible. Name and nature. His name, God's nature, is perfect good. And when I can think righteous thoughts, truth thoughts, then I am protected. I am in the midst of goodness. Goodness is all around me, and I partake of it. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. That's just it. It's all shadows. It isn't reality so much at the time. It isn't real. It is a shadow. And I will not fear it because God is with me always. God is my shield and buckler. God is my protector. God is my guide. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Now, the rod and the staff are emblems or ideas of power and guidance. Yes. That power in and around me, through me, that guidance, that will keep me out of fear, the fear of the shadow of something being taken from me, death, something that I need. No, no, with his help, that will never happen. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Now, a table is emblematic of life and divine abundance. The table is set with every wonderful thing. But it is in the presence of mine enemies. What are the enemies? There are no enemies out there. There are only enemies within, and there are thoughts. There are thoughts. That's where the enemies are. But as we turn away from those enemies and put our attention on this divine abundance that is with me and within me and all around me, then there is no more fear. Thou anointest my head with oil, which is the symbol of divine love. My cup runneth over, and the cup is emblematic of the spiritual life. Yeah, the spiritual life becomes so real, so part of our ongoing thoughts and experiences and interactions with people and things. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord, that is a consciousness of the presence of God forever. Forever. I said that many times to myself, thinking about what it meant. But just the first phrase, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. That by itself can move one out of the heaviness, the pain of fear. It can do wonders, and it did wonders for me, because I got peaceful. I finally got peaceful. I could really feel that all was in divine order. God was in charge, and whatever transpired would be fine. It would be right. It would be appropriate and exactly as it should be. There was nothing to fear. And that somehow healed me. Just as Dr. Fox suggested, get fear out of your heart. Pray until you're satisfied that God is with you. Work on yourself, and everything else takes care of itself. He said, that's the best treatment of all. And he was right. His words on healing are truth. You treat yourself, and the healing will take place. Thank you, Dr. Fox. Shall we go with him? And give thanks that, oh, these truths that we hear have a spiritual reality that transforms our lives when we embed ourselves mentally in the midst of them. We soak ourselves in that truth, the truth of the omnipresence of God. Scientific prayer is what Dr. Fox suggested. That is the practice of the presence of God. God is with me and within me, and there is nothing to fear. All is well. And we strive for that. Especially we strive for it when we get a piece of bad news, or our thoughts go to the what if kind of things. The enemy within is the thought, the negative thought. We turn our backs on it, and we feast on God's abundance. Beloved Father, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Amen.
I just made a slight adjustment, as I often do. I picked up on something you said, that love was unconditional. And so the tune I'm going to play, it's a ballad. It was written by Dolly Parton, and also recorded by Dolly Parton, and also by the late Whitney Houston. It's called I Will Always Love You.
Thank you.
have the blessing of the gifts. We thank you so much for your tithes and offerings, especially at this time when we're having some, we could describe them as extraordinary expenses. Thank you again. Shall we say our blessing of the gifts together? It's right here on the television. Today, I acknowledge God, omnipresent, as the source of all good, as the source of my good. With this acknowledgement, I accept His will, which is abundance in every aspect of my life. I release all thoughts of lack and limitation, and I am open and receptive to the increased flow of abundance to me right now. I joyfully accept the gifts of life and give freely of the special gift that I am. Through me, God omnipresent blesses and multiplies this gift for all. Thank you, dear God.
Hold on.
Nancy's going to share some announcements with us.
No, I'm not.
I am.
Hold Janet. On.
I'm Jan.
You said Nancy.
Oh. Thank you. Thank you. They confuse us all the time.
That's right. In a new job.
My apologies.
That's okay. She's the one with the spiky hair. Okay, I have a lot. Is this thing on? I hope so.
No. I turned it off.
I turned it on.
No, I mean, I turn it off when I lay it down.
I know, but I just turned it back on. Can y'all hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. All right, I have lots of announcements, so sit back and enjoy. Last week was birthday Sunday, and we didn't have birthday cake, but we had cookies. But Amy Jo bought the birthday cake today, and the birthday people are here today. One of them, Amy Jo, and Bill's birthday. So we're going to play happy birthday. So we have birthday cake today, so please come next door and have some after I get through with all the announcements. We probably won't lunch by then. The flowers today, which are beautiful, with the flowers have just been gorgeous, and the lady that does them, she just does such a great job. And Martha, again, sponsored them for the congregation, so feel free to take some and take some home and enjoy them. So thank you, Martha, for doing that. Gosh, we've got lots of things going on here. First off, we had some new bumper stickers made for the church, and these are window flames, and Nancy, you want to come up and maybe hold this up? Maybe you can even take it off and I'll just buy. Anyhow, somebody paid for the cost of those, and we're going to sell them to you for $5 a piece. So it's a little bit different than the ones we had before, and it's got the other ones didn't even have our website on it. So
it's a cling.
It's a window cling, and so I think we got 25 of them, so we're going to sell them for $5 a piece. So if anybody wants them after church, PC, Nancy or Ann, somebody that will take your money and give you a bumper sticker. Okay. Also, we did this a few years ago. We had these little cards we gave out when you went someplace that just said thank you for being who you are and what you do. But at the same time, we had that, but we didn't have our information on the card. So now we have made some new cards, and we have our address and our phone number and website on the back of the cards. Well, I have a few today, but if anybody wants it, I know we're not going a lot of places, but you never know when you might run into somebody you want to give them to. But we're going to just take some today, and we'll have some more and get them for next Sunday. So these are people really, you know, we just give them out to people, and people have been really grateful for them. So anyhow, make somebody's day and do that. Let's see, your IANS meeting Friday night, do you want to say anything about that?
Yes, we're going to have a very well-known speaker through Zoom, and she is going to be, her name is Ellen Dye, an experiencer, a person who's had spiritual experiences as well, and I think she'll be just wonderful to listen to. Unfortunately, I won't be able to be here, but I'll be able to Zoom in myself. In fact, this is going to be the last time I'm with you for a while, but all to the good, all to the good. And that's from 7 to 9, and you'll be able to ask her questions. Ellen Dye, our special guest on Friday.
Now, is your Wednesday night class going to continue while you're out?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, they're going on.
Okay. Everything else will continue on. And as most of you know, Maria's going to have a knee replacement and on the 19th, but she has to be quarantined starting today, so she probably won't go home at all today. After Because she goes after
tomorrow.
So she probably won't go home today, so she's going to be out enjoying everything. But we know that all is going to be well with her. And as I said last week, the people in the family can't keep up with her now. Wait till she gets that knee replaced, and so she'll So we'll be saying lots of prayers for her, and we know she'll be back here in this pulpit very soon. So we'll see that. And I know her children are going to see she's taken care of, and so with the congregation. So. I know in the past years we've had a Thanksgiving dinner here at the church for the folks that couldn't go anywhere or didn't have family, but we cannot do that this year because of the COVID. So we're still trying to figure out what we might be able to do to maybe get some people some lunch or something at home that don't have any. So I know we're still working on that, but we will not be having one at the church. We will be putting up our Christmas tree. We're still going to do that. We will put that up on this Saturday after Thanksgiving, which I think is the 28th. And we'll probably meet at about 10 o'clock, but I'll be announcing that closer to time for that to happen. We still got stuff going on in the store. Martha's put out some Christmas stuff, and we sold a lot of stuff last week, and it seems like the Christmas stuff is going pretty fast. So help yourself in there and buy whatever might meet your fancy. Let's see here. Our Christmas outreach this year, we decided to do, we're not going to have the stuffed animals under the tree like we did because of COVID and having to have special wrapping and all that. So that's not happening. But what we decided to do, again, is the food pantry for the MCC church. And also we'll take some of that food for some of the people in our own church that are in need. So we'll be doing that. Martha's already set up some boxes. Also, we're going to be collecting socks for the homeless and also special socks for the residents where Pam works. They have to have those socks with the little grippy things on the bottom of them. So we're going to be collecting, because last year we did poinsettias for them, and they said we couldn't do that this year, so we're going to collect the socks for them. So those are the things we'll be working on, and like I said, Martha already has boxes out for the socks and the food, so anytime you want to help with us, that would be great. So just a little update. As of course, you know, the furnace is fixed. Thank goodness for that, because last week was cold. This week is kind of warm, but that's okay. And I did meet with the roofer, the insurance guy this week, and the assessor. He got up on the roof, and he did say we had hail damage. He's filing a claim, but I haven't heard from the insurance company. Doug said it will probably be sometime this week before I will hear from the normal stuff. So we'll see what they have to say, but I do know we have a $1,000 deductible. Is that correct, Doug? You said on the policy?
Yep.
Okay. So anyhow, we'll be figuring that out once we hear from the insurance company. Again, with the furnace cost is $5,500, and we had two people that are volunteering to give money. In other words, and they'll match the donation. In other words, if you give $10, they'll give $10. If you give $100, they'll give $100. And they'll do this up to like $4,300. So we have a chance. This is a way for us to raise money because we can't do a lot of other fundraising. Basically, our store and our bumper stickers about all we've been able to do. So if you're willing to give any money for that, we're going to run that probably through the end of December, maybe through the end of January, because I know with the holidays and everything coming up, that people, but we'll run it and see how much money we're getting. And if the people want to extend their offer, then maybe we'll do it a little bit longer. But it is a good way for us to raise money and hopefully double our money. So anyhow, that's all good news, and just keep the faith. That's all you have to do. So that was one of my things. Marita was talking about how fearful she was, and for once I worked the poles. Maybe it's because I was just tired when I got home that night and I went to bed. But anyhow, I wasn't fearful. And when some of our congregation called me the next day, and I just kept saying, keep the faith, and that's what So, well, we did, it works. Thank goodness for this church. That's all I've got to say. Thank you. Anybody else have anything? I'll just talk to them. Okay. Thank you, Bill, for your beautiful music.
And now it's time for our final blessing. And we have to date been using that time as a time to bless our country. And I think that we should continue to do that, at least for a couple of weeks. We don't know how things are going to unfold, and we take this opportunity to lean on God. So shall we go within, and we will have another period of 90 seconds of silence where we can address God in our own unique and wonderful ways and know that He loves us and that good is coming forth. But we give thanks in advance for the blessing of understanding, of peace, of communication, the bringing together of those parts of our families, of our neighbors, our city, our state, our nation, that have not seen eye to eye, and perhaps never will, but will understand that everyone has the right to their opinion, the right to their vote, the right to their belief, and the right to turn to God for guidance. Today we take a deep breath of relief and gratitude that this good, greater good than we can imagine right now, is coming forth. And now, shall we have our 90 seconds of silence? We give thanks. We give thanks to God for His own perfect solution, His activity in our country and around the world, His blessing, His guidance, His protection. Thank you, dear God, that it is so. Amen.
Amen.